state in its discretionary exercise of powers. This emphasis on the observance of individual duties is seen most prominently in the Prime Minister's addresses to the nation. In his Mann Ki Baat episode yesterday, he called India's fight against the pandemic people-driven, pointing to an altruistic bent of mind that our citizens have demonstrated in other spheres as well, such as giving up their gas subsidies or senior citizens foregoing their railway subsidies. In this kind of public mood, when healthcare workers fear for their life, and the state sends out people who are dressed as Yamraj to terrorize those who don't, there doesn't seem to be much room for the discussion of patient rights. History, however, might have a different opinion about this. In the early stages of the pandemic, there was a lot of talk about how India was hampered by a 19th century law that was first pressed into service to tackle an outbreak of the bubonic plague in the state of Bombay. We lamented the fact that the act was not modern enough. It still spoke of ships and ports, and it couldn't even define a dangerous epidemic disease. There were also rights-based criticisms of the act, which were founded in the abuse by the colonial government of the powers conferred under it. I've been reading an interesting book called Colonizing the Body, State Medicine and Epidemic Disease in the 19th Century India by the historian David Arnold, who says that the measures adopted to combat epidemic plague in India were unprecedented in character and scale, and what is more interesting to me, provoked the greatest upsurge of public resistance to Western medicine and sanitation that 19th century India had witnessed. Now, some of the measures that the colonial government adopted would justly outrage us today. For example, several hundreds of slum dwellings in Bombay were destroyed using powers under the Municipal Corporation Act. However, some of the most intense public resistance at that time appears to have been to the enforced segregation and hospitalization of suspected patients. The colonial government, in a couple of years after the plague outbreak had burst on the scene, published a report that documented the history of the progress of the plague in Bombay. And I'm going to quote from the report. It says, "Of all the measures that were taken at this time for combating plague, the one which caused most alarm was segregation or removal to hospital. The people not only regarded hospital treatment with detestation, but reports were freely circulated that the authorities merely took them there to make a speedy end of them. A gang of scoundrels took to blackmailing by personating the police and municipal servants and increased the general terror, extorting money as they did under threats of removal to hospital." Now, this resistance to hospitalization was founded partially in ignorance and partially in the terror of being cut off from one's relatives. For example, a Pune newspaper at that time described hospital servants as callous and patent mercenaries, in contrast to the Corona Warriors title that we confer that seems to be popular in the media today. And partially the resistance to hospitalization, and this is most repugnant of all, was in the fear that caste requirements would not be respected in hospitals. So Arnold writes about a story run by the Kesari, a Marathi newspaper, which was run by Bal Gangadhar Tilak, which describes the plight of a Brahmin who had been forced to live on milk while in hospital because the food he was offered had been polluted by being served by a Shudra. In the same kind of vein, there was patriarchal horror about men who were forced to contemplate the idea of their wives, sisters, and daughters being examined by white male doctors. Now, ultimately, the colonial government was forced to conciliate the public by moderating its more extreme plague control measures, accepting that large numbers of deaths I can just see a chat. Yes, I can switch on my video. Just a second. Yeah, I'm sorry. Sorry about that. I'll just continue. So the as I said, public hostility. Sorry, I was talking about the colonial government conciliating the public by moderating its more extreme plague control measures. And it did so while accepting that large numbers of death were in consequence unavoidable. Now, at that time, public hostility to the government's measures was the product of a lack of trust in the colonial rulers, unchecked misinformation, and rightly or wrongly, disrespect to the social norms of that time. Now, although they may not immediately seem like it, these are all integral aspects of patient rights: accountability, access to information, and cultural acceptability. Would the colonial government's measures have met with more acceptance had they been alive to this notion of patient rights? I can't really hazard an answer to this counterfactual. But I'm asking this question only to emphasize that the idea of patient rights is not irrelevant to a pandemic. In fact, the idea might hold the key to the control of a pandemic by building acceptance for tough measures. Now, measures that were considered harsh in 19th century colonial India will not be viewed in the same light today. For instance, it's highly unlikely that anyone will publicly voice opposition to compulsory quarantine for suspected COVID-19 patients. However, the number of patients who have attempted to flee quarantine facilities belies the acceptance of this measure. For example, in the last 48 hours, there have already been at least 3 reports from different parts of the country of such escapes. Most reports speak about unsanitary conditions that are forcing people to run away. An Al Jazeera story of the 24th of April quotes the Ministry of Home Affairs, which acknowledges that there have been at least 27 clashes at quarantine centers over the last 10 days. A tailor quarantined at a community hall in Calcutta reported that there were only 2 toilets available for use amongst 80 women. All of us have undoubtedly seen videos circulating on social media depicting clogged toilets and dirty beds and inedible food, and have been suitably horrified by them. All of us are also on WhatsApp groups, or at least have relatives on WhatsApp groups, who have equally quickly been suitably reassured that you can pay to be quarantined in a luxury hotel. Now, this is really in contrast to So while the opposition in 1879 to hospitals and quarantine facilities was equally vociferous, the reason was very different. At that time, the hospital was relatively the cleanest place one could be put in, purely in medical terms. In the casteist vocabulary of that time, hospitals were polluted. Today, we can't say the same about quarantine facilities. That is, we can't make the same kind of guarantees about their sanitariness. Now, the lack of hygiene across quarantine facilities is problematic in itself, but it points to a deeper problem. The stigma associated with the patient, suspected or otherwise, of an infectious disease, and the AIIMS director, Dr. Guleria, has recently spoken about this stigma and the obstacle that it poses to providing proper care. And this lack of hygiene also points to another deeper problem, which is the lack of dignity in the provision of care. Now, although most healthcare workers are performing an outstanding job at great personal risk to themselves and their families, there are bound to be instances of neglect. And one of these is a horrifying account that I came across of the isolation facilities at the Seven Hills Hospital in Mumbai, where there are terrible accounts of an elderly woman's diaper not being changed for nearly a day, of medicines being thrown at patients because nurses and ward boys didn't want to come close, patients not being provided a change of clothes, used trays and cups not being cleared for days on end. Now, stories like this incite shock, dismay, disgust even, and they might have the unfortunate effect of incentivizing persons to hide their symptoms. And this is obviously a challenge to the control of a public health crisis of this scale. But we've been speaking so far only about COVID-19 patients, so the patients of the pandemic themselves. So truly heartbreaking stories really at the moment are of non-COVID-19 patients who have been forced to reveal the symptoms of diseases that they have been living with in order to access medicine and treatment during the lockdown, which they otherwise could access with a guarantee of privacy and confidentiality. Now, the prime example of something like this is tuberculosis. So with healthcare workers and services being enlisted to address the pandemic, TB patients have been unable to access their medication from local DOTS centers. And they haven't received information on how they should be managing their disease during this time, nor have they received the monetary assistance that is otherwise guaranteed to them under state schemes. Now, the social stigma that is associated with diseases like this, as well as AIDS, makes it doubly difficult for patients to make requests for help. As an activist working with HIV-positive persons observed, district treatment centers are often 30 or 40 kilometers away from a patient's place of residence. This requires patients to make an application for a travel pass to the police, and this application itself forces them to disclose their HIV-positive status, which they otherwise need not have. Now, the Health Ministry has recently issued guidelines to state governments directing them to ensure doorstep delivery of TB medication if necessary, and has advised TB patients themselves to continue their treatment as prescribed. But how this is to be accomplished remains unclear. Now, what do these accounts of both COVID and non-COVID patients tell us about patient rights? To my own mind, this is not immediately clear. For example, unclean quarantine facilities indicate a lack of capacity, especially of human resources, and they indicate failings in human behavior. As for TB patients, the hoops that they must jump through in order to access their treatment and receive their medication indicates a broken public health system and an access issue, a right to health issue. What do either of these issues have to do with patient rights? Now, this brings us to the crux of the lecture, really, which is, what do we mean by patient rights? Now, there isn't really any singular conception of the body of patient rights or who they are available against. The World Health Organization, for example, has a short piece on patient rights where it admits that these rights vary across jurisdictions depending upon prevailing cultural and social norms, although there is a common understanding that patient rights are grounded in the inherent dignity and equality of all human beings, which is true of most other fundamental rights. There is, however, some growing international consensus about certain key components of these rights. So, for example, the right to privacy and confidentiality of medical information, the right to consent or to refuse treatment, and the right to be informed about the risk of relevant medical procedures. Now, the WHO also suggests, and I'll come back to these components to suggest that perhaps during the time of a pandemic, even these core components of patient rights are snatched away or don't receive the protection that they are otherwise entitled to. Now, the WHO suggests that the form that each of these patient rights takes in each jurisdiction depends upon a particular model of the physician-patient relationship that is prevalent in that jurisdiction. Now, this again is based on a 1992 article by Ezekiel and Emmanuel, who described four models of the physician-patient relationship, which I'll take you through very briefly. And then I'll suggest what patient rights might look like under each of these models. So the first model, which is known as the paternalistic model, or also the parental model or the priestly model, or as I would call it, the doctor knows best model, is a model that ensures that patients receive the interventions that best promote their health and well-being. So the physician presents the patient with selected information that will encourage the patient to consent to a particular intervention that the physician considers best. Now, in the extreme version of this model, the idea of patient autonomy is non-existent. The physician informs the patient about what intervention is best, and that intervention is then initiated. So in this model, the physician acts as the patient's guardian. And the underlying assumption is that there is an objective understanding of the patient's best interests, which the physician is capable of determining. Now, in my mind, patient rights under this kind of model most closely resemble the fiduciary duty of care that characterizes any other relationship that is based on trust. Now, how do we think about this in the time of a pandemic? So during a pandemic, there is a shift from individual physician-patient interactions to the relationship between the citizen and the state. So if we were to apply a paternalistic model during a pandemic, we would assume that the state owes a duty of care to its citizens. The state acts in the best interests of citizens, and the state acts for the collective good. Now, this model leaves very little room for individual patient rights during a public health emergency. But that doesn't mean it doesn't impose any obligations on states at all. It does demand action from the state in the sense that the state must justify that it is guided by sound policy. The next model is the informative model or the consumer model, where the objective of the physician-patient interaction is to provide the patient with all the relevant information that the patient can use to select the medical intervention they want. I mean, this is the kind of model that we are used to seeing in commercialized, developed, primarily in the Western world and especially the US, where the role of the physician is simply to provide the information and then execute the medical intervention that is selected by the patient. So the physician in this model is seen as a technical expert whose obligations include providing accurate, truthful information and demonstrating competence in their area of expertise. Patients, in this model, patient autonomy is at its strongest. So patients continue to retain control over medical decision making. Now, how again, to think about how to transpose this kind of model to the legal framework for, to the conceptual framework for patient rights. Now, obviously, since this is a consumer model, the patient rights that are exercised most closely resemble consumer rights that are exercised against healthcare professionals and establishments who are cast in the mold of service providers. Now, this is the hardest kind of model to replicate or to think about during a pandemic, because it's very difficult to see the state as a service provider during an emergency of this nature. It's also very difficult to allow room for the millions of individual choices based on information that the state provides. Now, the nature of a pandemic requires a uniform, coordinated response that is defeated by allowing citizens to act solely in their own personal interests. Now, for example, even in the United States, where this consumer model reigns supreme in non-pandemic times, patient rights as consumer rights can't really be carried through to their logical conclusion. If they are, you get Trump supporters carrying around placards that reject lockdowns and the wearing of face masks and that are plastered with slogans that say, my body, my choice, or give me liberty or give me COVID-19. So this brings us to the last two models, which actually I find a little difficult to distinguish myself, but they are known as the interpretive and deliberative models. Now, under the first one, under the interpretive model, the physician assists the patient in identifying and articulating the patient's own values and helping the patient determine which medical intervention best fits those values. So the physician is really acting as an interpreter for the patient, helping them apply their personal values to medical decision making. So the idea of patient autonomy under this model is one of self-realization. So the patient through the doctor's intervention comes to know more clearly who they are and how various medical options bear on their identity. The deliberative model is similar to this because it also requires the physician to assist the patient in arriving at a decision. But the values that are chosen here are not the patient's own. They are the best health-related values that can be realized in a clinical situation. So, I mean, to give you a practical example, if there was if a particular patient had breast cancer and was worried about the effect that chemotherapy would have on their quality of life, in the first model, in the interpretive model, the doctor would assist the patient in arriving at a course of medical treatment that minimized the effects of that chemotherapy, for example. In the deliberative model, they might nudge the patient towards exercising altruism by entering a clinical trial to test a new drug for breast cancer, because participation in a clinical trial and contributing to health research and innovation is a health-related value that is desirable for a society. So the values that are to be chosen in the deliberative model are not the patient's own, but the best health values that can be realized in any clinical situation. So instead of self-realization here, the physician is pushing the patient towards a model of moral self-development. Now, how do we conceive of patient rights under both the interpretive and the deliberative model of physician-patient interaction? So under both these models, the physician and the patient are both required to engage in a process of shared decision-making. So this model doesn't contemplate an absolute right for the patient to consent to or to refuse treatment. Instead, there is a dialogue between the patient and the physician with the aim of identifying a course of action that will realize certain values. Now, again, to bring the conversation back to a pandemic, the interpretive model can't really help in a pandemic because the state can't help individuals realize their individual wishes and preferences. The deliberative model, on the other hand, does provide some scope for the state and its citizens to arrive at a mutual understanding of the health-related values that their society prizes. Now, this process might result in very different decisions from country to country. So, for example, in the Netherlands, you might decide to build herd immunity, while in New Zealand, you might decide to go in hard and go in early with a stringent lockdown. But what's important to remember is that it's built in both these cases on a mutual consensus of the values that society stands for. Now, it's hard to identify which one of these four models characterizes patient-physician interaction in the Indian context. So if we were to go simply by the Consumer Protection Act, the informative model is predominant. I mean, the legal framework governing interactions between physicians and patients is a consumer service provider transaction. But if we were to closely examine the nature of interactions, from an anthropological lens, the paternalistic model is the one that would really dominate. Doctors are want to say that, when patients approach them, they understand the idea of informed consent, but they're very often faced with patients who tell them, "Doctor saab, aap bataiye kya karna hai." Now, patient rights, however, can't be limited simply to physician-patient interactions. They extend beyond this to healthcare establishments and to the state as well. Now, this is what was recognized in the draft Charter of Patient Rights that was proposed for adoption by the National Human Rights Commission and later adopted quite recently by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Now, this charter identifies certain very specific patient rights, associated duty bearers, as well as the instruments in which these rights are expressed. So, for example, the right to information states that every patient has the right to adequate, relevant information about the nature of their illness and expected costs of treatment. And this right is protected through standards framed under the Clinical Establishments Act, professional obligations or the Code of Ethics under the Medical Council of India, and also standards under the National Accreditation Board for Hospitals, and of course the Consumer Protection Act. Now, not all of these instruments have binding legal value, which is again something I'll return to towards the end of the lecture. But this draft charter provides us a useful map of the various policies, guidelines, and statutes that embody these rights. Now, this patient rights charter has identified 17 rights in total, these including the right to information that I just mentioned. Now, as I said earlier, these are a set of very highly specific rights, right from the right to choose the source of medicines and tests, to the right to obtain a second opinion, an alternative opinion, to the right to receive the body of the deceased from the hospital. So these are actually, as in these rights have been identified based on the basis of patient rights group that have been working on these issues for a while and have realized that these are some of the biggest roadblocks in ensuring that patients are treated with dignity and equality in healthcare settings, in the right to dignity and the right to privacy and the right against non-discrimination. And perhaps it might be an interesting exercise for those of you who are, who are keen to do this, to go through each of these rights and examine the extent to which they are capable of being enforced in a pandemic. But I'm going to discuss three of these broader rights with you, each of which I think is integral to the idea of a patient right. It is either being diluted or subverted during a pandemic. So let's take the first right, the right to non-discrimination. Now, in the Indian Patient Rights Charter, this right states that every patient has the right to receive treatment without any discrimination based on his or her illnesses or conditions, including HIV status or other health conditions, or discrimination based on caste, ethnicity, religion, gender, sexual orientation, linguistic or geographical or social origins. Now, obviously, discrimination on the basis of religion, caste, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation remains entirely off limits during a pandemic. But there isn't the same kind of ethical or legal consensus about discrimination based on illness, based on the basis of illness or other conditions, or even discrimination on the basis of age. So fortunately, India at least has not yet had to confront a shortage of life-saving equipment to have to contemplate this question. But countries who have already seen the worst of the pandemic have developed ventilator allocation guidelines because they have been forced to confront the fact that discrimination on the basis of age might no longer be a hypothetical question for them. Now, medical professionals disagree quite vehemently on these issues. So, for example, to take the question of ventilator allocation, the Journal of the American Medical Association called for ventilator allocation to take into consideration the number of years of life saved. So this would constitute some kind of age-based discrimination. On the other hand, an equally respected medical professional body, the American College of Physicians, countered this with a public statement that warned against this kind of age discrimination, arguing that a younger person should be given preference for scarce medical care only when that person had a better short-term prognosis, and not simply because the person was younger. Even allocating on the basis of short-term prognosis, if you think about it, is ultimately a proxy for discriminating on the basis of other illnesses and conditions. And there is a genuine worry that this kind of allocation will discriminate against persons with physical and intellectual disabilities, as well as the elderly. For example, Alabama was forced to retract guidelines that stated that persons with intellectual disabilities would be ineligible for ventilator care. I mean, that was obviously an outrageous kind of criterion. But the very fact that medical professionals are having this kind of conversation at the moment, and the fact that this sort of the legal position on this is entirely unclear, suggests that perhaps the patient right to non-discrimination is not acting as a trump, as an absolute bar, in the way that it should be. If it were, I mean, this debate, we wouldn't really be having this kind of debate. This brings me to the second core component of a patient right, which is the right to informed consent, and one that is recognized both in our patient charter as well as generally internationally. Now, it's quite obvious that the right to informed consent completely breaks down in the context of a pandemic. And I mean that only in a very specific sense, but the fact that, yes, the state has been obtaining informed consent from patients before testing them for COVID-19, but it's clear that there really isn't a choice. It's mandatory to get tested. Similarly, as long as we have compulsory quarantine, the right to informed consent doesn't really exist in this scenario. There does exist the choice to refuse life-saving treatment during this pandemic, should you desire to do so. And potentially, you can refuse other treatment as well, although I'm not really aware of something like this having been exercised. But no one is at liberty to refuse a quarantine. You are subject to punishment under Section 188 of the Indian Penal Code, and now under some states that have passed other ordinances, an even higher penalty. So no, in the United States, for example, there have been arguments that informed consent and patient rights are jeopardized by mandatory vaccination. But the argument here is limited not to the fact that you are required to submit to a procedure that you don't want to, but because of a lack of information. So for example, in the context of the HPV vaccine for cervical cancer in the US, the argument was that informed consent was violated because there were deficiencies in the data about the vaccine's safety and efficacy, which were not adequately disclosed to patients. So at best, if we were to follow this argument to its logical conclusion, it suggests that states are at least under an obligation to explain the rationale for compulsory isolation. But the absolute right to patient autonomy, the right to refuse to be submitted to quarantine, doesn't work again as a trump in this context. And finally, the third is the right to confidentiality. I won't spend too much time on this because even the patient rights charter itself acknowledges that the right to privacy and the confidentiality of patient information is limited during times of public health emergencies. So at least this right has limitations that are already built in. And as we can see, for example, this is absolutely necessary in a pandemic. Even, for example, something as basic as contact tracing will require at least disclosing to a third person the fact of a patient's COVID-19 status. Now, can we argue that these are not true patient rights simply because they are breached during a pandemic? You could say that a pandemic is simply a public health emergency, and any rights jurisprudence understands the limitation of rights in the public interest, especially in the time of an emergency. Now, this is right. Although in my opinion, the pandemic is not so much a restriction on patient rights as their negation, at least if you look at the right to informed consent and the right to non-discrimination in certain contexts. So a more compelling argument against the recognition of patient rights as rights in the true sense is the weakness of their enforceability. And now this really depends on what is the setting in which you view patient rights. So for a right to be legally enforceable, it requires obligations to be imposed. And in the context of patient rights, it requires obligations to be imposed on healthcare workers, healthcare establishments, and the state. Now, this, in my opinion, requires not just a Consumer Protection Act, but a more robust healthcare regulatory regime that holds all these duty holders to clear safety, quality, and other standards that are relevant to the protection of patient rights. Now, our regulatory regime for healthcare in India is appalling, and it really is one of the key reasons for violence against healthcare workers, to which the answer is not really another law that creates yet another criminal offense. So one way of viewing patient rights is to see them as informing a regulatory regime. A complementary approach is to develop a framework around, to not use the language of patient rights, as some scholars have argued, but to develop a legal framework around human rights in patient care. So, for example, Cohen and Easer, and you can look up this article, it's in the Journal of Health and Human Rights, suggests that instead of looking at patient rights, we look at human rights in patient care as providing a principled alternative to this growing commercialization of patient care and healthcare service provision. So the idea of human rights in patient care derives from inherent human dignity and equality, and applies and neutrally applies universal, legally recognized human rights principles that protect both patients and providers, and that admit of limitations that can be justified by human rights norms. So essentially what this means is, at least in the Indian context, is to think about how patient rights can be built into our understanding of the right to health, or how should they feed into our Article 21 jurisprudence on health rights. Now, admittedly, this is an interesting approach for India, because we have an expansive rights jurisprudence in any case. And our current rights, our right to health jurisprudence is fairly limited. It's, it recognizes limited rights to emergency medical care and has been applied in the context of intellectual property claims. But we are still to have a sort of a coherent conception of what a right to health imposes. One, actually, what a right to health entitles a patient to in terms of actual goods and services. And the second, what structural obligations it imposes on the state to ensure the protection of health. So if we really are going to ground the patient rights in the right to health, we will need some intelligent strategic litigation to advance these claims. And second, we'll need robust grievance redressal mechanisms in healthcare establishments. And third, I think we will need rights-based health legislation that provides, one, a framework for dealing with public health emergencies, as well as beyond that. And by recognizing that what patient rights really require, at least during public emergencies, if not otherwise, is accountability, transparency, and participation. So not necessarily a basket of goods and services, but certain kinds of behavior on the part of the state that go some way towards protecting patient rights. Now, I'm going to end in a minute. And I'll go back to the 1897 plague. So patient rights at that time, at least people believed that patients in colonial India were protected from epidemics like smallpox and cholera by the actions of goddesses like Sitala Devi and Ola Bibi. These were the respective deities for smallpox and cholera. Now, we don't have a 21st century deity, or if we do, it's probably WhatsApp and its equivalent on social media. So while people in colonial India saw the visitations of smallpox and cholera as the actions of irate goddesses, Our explanations for events like the current pandemic are furnished by the information that we consume. When the plague first broke out in India, there was no deity for the plague. There was no one who could be propitiated. And this is why perhaps, again, historians argue that the state's actions to control plague confounded people at that time. Now for us, the Sitala Devi and the Ola Bibi of our times, I would argue, are a more rational public health emergency legislation and a rights-based regulatory framework that promotes human rights in patient care. Thanks. I'm very happy to take any questions.
Thank you, ma'am, for that informative session on the different types of models between patient-doctor relationship and the three important rights. So we have a couple of questions, and I'll start with a question by Ms. Ridhi Shetty.
Okay.
So you mentioned about contact tracing, and she is asking that with respect to patients' right to privacy and the need to contact trace and map patient data, mm-hmm. for the pandemic, can you share the insights on privacy and biopolitics at hands of the state?
Okay, I'm not entirely sure what biopolitics means, to be honest, but at least as far as contact tracing itself is concerned, as I understood it, and I might be wrong, it requires you to at least inform another person that, as in to inform all contacts of an infected COVID patient that they have been in contact with someone who has now tested positive. Now, I think this can be accomplished without having to disclose the identity of the person who has tested positive. So perhaps contact tracing in itself need not necessarily require the disclosure of your personal medical status to a third person. However, it will require its disclosure to the state. So in a pandemic, it's not just you and your physician who have this information, but the entire state machinery has this information. And this is what will be the case with the Arogya Setu app that the government wants to use as well in order to create more real-time information about the physical location of people and to allow other people to assess who they have been in contact with. Now, all kinds of privacy legislation recognize exceptions like this in the context of public health emergencies. So, unfortunately, we don't have a privacy protection legislation yet. So I hope, I haven't looked at the arrangements that the Arogya app, for example, has made to address privacy concerns. But hopefully these will comply with the safeguards that are necessary. I mean, as I understand it, technology can now... we can generate some useful insights for public health through anonymized data while requiring minimal intrusion of privacy. But yeah, there is no denying that privacy will to some extent and patient confidentiality to some extent will certainly be diluted.
Thank you, ma'am, so much for that response. There's one more question asking whether right to health under Article 21 is enough, or do we need to build upon this jurisprudence when issues of accessibility are also under Article 14 and 15 of the Constitution are also relevant?
Yeah, I mean, see, this is a tough one, because courts have, there's a lot of scope for the courts to, and they have used Article 21 to interpret, so the right to various socioeconomic rights in different expansive ways. Yeah. I would always argue that the right, that jurisprudence can go only so far. So judicial interpretation can play perhaps one precedent setting role. But if we are to have an entire machinery for the enforcement of the right to health in a systematic and accountable manner, then I believe personally that we will need a legislative intervention for this. Because my worry with judicial intervention is that it will make only piecemeal changes, which sometimes might have unequal or adverse consequences, and that they will simply not be able to give the issue the sort of holistic attention that it deserves. So I'd say that while it can take the first steps in that direction, properly enshrining the right to health in the Indian context will require legislation.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. And so the next question has been asked by two set of participants. One is Mr. Yash Dodani, and other is Dr. Wander, a cardiologist. So they're basically asking is whether can we argue that the right to refuse a particular form of treatment or a test would not be considered a right in the context of a pandemic, since that would result in causing public harm?
Yeah, possibly. As in, I don't see how you can call something a right when you might be penalized for refusing it. So if you refuse to submit to an official who is demanding that you be tested, currently under our legal framework, you're liable to be punished under the Section 188 of the Indian Penal Code. If that's the case, then it's a bit of a stretch to call your right to refuse treatment a right. I'm not saying that that right doesn't exist outside of a pandemic, but potentially you could say that during the time of a pandemic, you could say there's a limitation on this right, but I would possibly go further and say that perhaps this right doesn't exist at all. Although that's not entirely fair. As I mentioned earlier, you know, even if you are, assuming you've been hospitalized for COVID and now the question is whether you should be put on a ventilator or not, you will still retain the right to refuse that kind of life-saving treatment. So to that extent, the right exists. But to the extent that your refusal constitutes a violation of the statute, then no, that's not a right.
Thank you, ma'am. During the lecture, you also mentioned about violence against healthcare workers, and you suggested that the new ordinance wouldn't be as effective as a robust regulatory regime. Can you please elaborate on that? This question was asked by Mr. Tushit.
Sure. So one, I fully understand, and I'm not discounting the symbolic value of a harsher law like the one that has been passed. And sure, if it is able to deter people from, committing wanton acts of violence, that's well and good. My concerns are, one, that obviously this ordinance is restricted only to violence during an epidemic. So it doesn't address violence against healthcare workers that we know exists outside of this scenario as well. Two, the experience with enforcing this kind of criminal legislation has been very poor. So we really haven't seen many convictions many convictions under specific state acts that have criminalized violence against healthcare personnel. And third, I believe that it's important to discuss not just violence against healthcare workers, but there are all kinds of other occupational risks and hazards that healthcare workers are subjected to. And for that, we need a more robust occupational health and safety framework. So, again, the US, an example of this is the Occupational Health and Safety Act, which is supposed to notify standards for protecting the health and safety at the workplace, which includes healthcare workers. We don't have an equivalent of that here, and that leaves the protection of healthcare workers to the mercy of sort of individual healthcare establishments. Given that our regulatory regime for healthcare establishments in general is really not very strong.
So, ma'am, just extending upon that question, would the legislations or acts within by the state government suffice, or do you think we need a central regulatory regime?
No, as in one, I don't think that the existing laws suffice because they are only focused on criminalizing violence. Okay. They are not focused on imposing obligations on employers, by which I mean on healthcare establishments, both public and private, to take positive steps to prevent that violence and two, to provide support to healthcare workers once they have actually been submitted to that violence. So, you know, there have to be mechanisms and protocols in place that that reduce this kind of violence. And two, if there is an incident of violence, you know, you need to provide paid leave, counseling, rehabilitation to healthcare workers as well. So our current laws don't do that. A new law can do this either at the central level or I think at the state level. Both, given that medical professionals are on the concurrent list, both governments would have the competence to legislate on something like this.
True. So we have one more question by Mr. Utkarsh Mani. He is asking, which of the Indian government's response to the pandemic can be explained as shortcomings of the existing healthcare system rather than just poor implementation?
Okay.
For example, the testing being done is far below its full capacity. Is that because of the implementation or because of the system that has been in place?
I mean, I'd probably say it's a combination of both. You know, you could argue that the state could have done more to procure testing kits earlier. But we could also argue that the fact that we don't have a proper framework for medical devices regulation is and this is a more long-term answer, has contributed to a lack of innovation within the Indian medical device sector. And then, for example, why do we have to import these kits? Why don't we have the capacity to build these kits ourselves? And I think partially the answer to that is not having a facilitative regulatory regime in place.
All right. So we have one more question by Ms. Malavika Parthasarthi. She is asking that if a situation like age discrimination in the allocation of ventilators were to arise in India, like in Italy or Spain, what are the possible constitutional arguments that one could make for and against this practice?
Sure. I mean, of course, you could argue that this is an irrational classification, which doesn't have a legitimate nexus to the objects being sought to be achieved, because the object being sought to be achieved, and this would depend on what you called your what you identified as your objective. I mean, if your object was to save the greatest lives of the greatest number of lives, potentially age discrimination is a valid criterion. But if you were to say that your objective is to, you know, is to ensure that medical resources are used to provide effective treatment, then there's no real rationale for why you shouldn't, as in if you can save a person who is, if a 60-year-old and a 40-year-old have an equally effective shot at being saved, there's no rational reason for discriminating on the basis of age. As far as arguments for this go, I mean, you could say, again, I think it would depend on how you framed what your goal was, really. And if you could justify that the goal of this exercise was to use resources effectively, I know I'm not making very much sense. I'm trying to think through what this would mean, how this would stand up to a constitutional challenge. And I do think you'd have to make the case that this was in the public interest, that it was a legitimate goal to try and save as many people as possible. It would depend on how you defined how many people you were saving. So, for example, were you going to count people based on the quality of life years or the lifespan that is left? These are all factors that the court would potentially examine to see whether they were rational or not. I think, for example, discriminating on the basis of simply of only on age might be an irrational criterion, because you could argue that just saving life years doesn't necessarily mean saving the lives of the greatest number of people. But I have to think about this properly. It's a good question.
So I think I'll just ask one more last question for the day. The sure. question is by Mr. Ankush Rai. So if in a hypothetical situation, if the state makes a law which mandates cured patients from COVID-19 to donate the plasma, how would that...
Sorry, could you repeat that?
So if a state makes a law which mandates cured patients of COVID-19 to donate their plasma for that plasma therapy, how would this fit in the framework of right of patient rights?
Yeah, this is also interesting because, again, this is an Article 21 argument. If you were to challenge, say, a direction like this for its constitutionality, and sorry, to Malvika's previous question as well, perhaps an argument against that kind of age-based discrimination is that it basically violates the right to life of an individual. Similarly here, you'd have to, I'm not sure if you'd be able to, if you were being forced to donate your plasma, I'm not sure if that would reach the level of an Article 21 violation. And potentially, in which case, it might not be constitutionally protected. As far as being statutorily protected, see, there are already, the right to refuse treatment is an expression of your right to bodily autonomy, which I agree is part of the right to life. But I think you'd have to do some work to prove how donating your plasma reached the level of violating your right to life. As far as other protections of it go, I mean, this is protected under the common law as well, and it's protected. We don't really have any other statutory protections for this. But I imagine that something like this, if I were arguing on behalf of the state, I would make the same kinds of arguments that I would for something like compulsory vaccination or quarantine, that the public need was so great that it did require this kind of intervention. But I'll have to make sure that it was proportionate and narrowly tailored to make sure that it wasn't the state was intervening only to the extent that was necessary. But I think you could make the argument that something like this would be permissible.
Thank you, ma'am. I think on that note, it is time for us to wrap up. Thank you so much for answering all the questions and for the amazing session. And I want to thank all the participants who could join us. And I'm sorry if I could not take up all the questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much.